Okay, Michael, so what are our features when we have a bunch of documents, let's say full of words?
I'm not sure. It could be things like the number of words in the document.
That could be. But what's sort of the, and actually that's a perfectly reasonable thing. What's the simplest set of features that you might start with from which you might then compute more interesting features?
Well, there's a super duper big set of features, which are the words.
Right. So in fact, that is exactly what we have, is we have words. Maybe we have punctuations and words are sort of the obvious thing to do. I typed in machine learning. Why don't I just return every single document that has machine followed by learning?
Maybe you should.
Maybe I should, and maybe that's a perfectly reasonable thing to do in the case of machine learning. Should I return documents that contain the word machine but don't contain the word learning?
I wouldn't score them very highly.
Ah, I might not score them as highly, but I might still return them as being at least more relevant than documents that contain neither machine nor learning.
Right, that are just about turtles, say.
Right, exactly. Although it's turtles all the way down, Michael.
I see.
Okay, so if our features are words, which are sort of the most obvious things to get at, we can compute other things like the number of words or whatever. But basically, our features are going to be words or counts of words or something like that. This is sort of a reasonable first step. And in fact, the very early retrieval systems, which predate both of us, actually, Michael, used simple things like words. Now, there's a lot of way details to this you could imagine. Like maybe you'd want to transform all plurals into their singular version and get rid of words like the. And there's a bunch of complicated stuff you might want to do, but it's not particularly relevant for this discussion. So just assume whatever you want to assume about the kinds of words that you have. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. So what's the problem with using words? Can you think of any problems with using words?
Well, there's a lot of them.
Right. That's actually the first thing. There's a lot of words, which means there are a lot of features, which means the curse of dimensionality is going to hurt us.
I would think that they'd be pretty good indicators of meaning, except I guess there's kind of two complementary problems. One is that some words mean more than one thing.
I like that. So we have good indicate words are good indicators of meaning because, they're words. But you could be in the case where you have words mean multiple things. You said there were two problems. What's the second one?
Sort of the opposite, which is you can say the same thing using completely different words.
Ah, yes. So that's that many words mean the same thing. And in particular, words, the fact that words can have multiple meanings is called polysemy. The fact that many words can mean the same thing is called synonymy. So can you think of a word that might have multiple meanings that indicates the problem of polysemy?
Well, so, learning in the machine learning example, learning sometimes refers to this statistical process that we've been talking about, but it also refers to the thing that people do, and in some scenarios, it actually means to teach. Like, I'm going to learn you something.
That's true, but that's just too on point. I'm going to pick something else that I think you will appreciate at the end. Let's think of a word like car. So car has multiple meanings, Michael. Can you think of them?
I'm mostly stuck on one at the moment, unless
Which one
we're
is
thinking
that?
of the vehicle that you drive around, but
Yes.
I guess one could also be referring to a list deconstructor in Lisp.
Yes, exactly. It's the first in a, what are those things called?
A cons cell.
Cons, thank you. Right, so car is either an automobile or it's the first element in a cons cell, which all of you people who've heard of Lisp knows is an awesome reference. For those of you who've never used Lisp, which is clearly the greatest language ever written in all of history or that ever will be written, because it is a superset and subsumes all other languages, including natural languages, imagine this word instead is apple. And so apple can refer to a fruit or it can refer to a computer company or to a music company for that matter. But I prefer car. So car can mean automobile or it can mean the first element in a cons cell if you're using Lisp. Now, sticking to this car example, synonymy is a similar problem in that car and automobile often refer to the same thing. So do you see this? So polysemy is the problem of a word meaning multiple things, and synonymy is the problem of multiple words meaning the same thing. And a particular word, like car in this case, can cause both polysemy problems and synonymy problems.
Yeah, I could see that. So in the example that you gave before about machine learning, you would, if you just returned documents that had machine and learning right after each other, then you'd miss all the stuff on, for example, data mining.
Right. In fact, that's a very good example. So there's a huge split in the community between those who care about data mining and those who care about machine learning. And often the people in one camp don't believe the people in the other camp are doing what they're doing. But for the person who isn't religiously committed to one of those camps or the others, when you talk about machine learning, you probably also care about data mining. When you talk about data mining, you probably also care about what people inside the field might call instead machine learning. And so you would be missing out on a whole swath of papers or interesting discussions if you happen to put in the word machine learning. But similarly, if you put in the word like data mining, you might end up getting all kinds of documents that are about the data or about the data that you get when you literally mine for coal. Who knows? And it would cause you huge problems for getting exactly the relevant set of documents that you want. So we can actually talk about this in terms of the kind of errors that you get in, say, supervised learning. What kind of errors do Polysemy give you, Michael?
There's false positive and false negative. And this is one of the things where it's going to return things that aren't relevant. It's going to say they're positive when they're not. So you've given me the answer, false positive.
Okay, that's right, false positive. By contrast, synonymy gives you what?
True positives.
No.
Wait, I negated the wrong word. False negatives.
Exactly.
In other words, it's going to – wait, is that right? So false negative means, it's going to tell you something's not there when it actually really is.
Right. So typing in car will not just give me the automobile articles about my Tesla, which is a black P85 with black leather, fully loaded, and is like the greatest car on the planet, but it will also give me really awesome, but in this case, not what I'm looking for, documents about Lisp. Meanwhile, when I type in car, I will actually get all these things on automobiles, but I won't get articles that talk about automobiles without actually using the word car. So you can imagine that these sorts of problems come up all the time. You've got a set of features, in this case, words, which have this problem that although they're good indicators, they're insufficient. That is, we have a set of features that will generate both false positives and false negatives on their own, and more to the point, doing feature selection will not solve this problem. I can throw away a bunch of irrelevant words and even useless words, but I'm still going to have this problem of generating false positives or polysemy and false negatives or synonymy. And this goes beyond simply information retrieval and text retrieval into any generic problem where you have possibly a large set of features that have this problem of false negatives and false positives.